financially as well as spiritually, and how God wants to move through this ministry. So with that, it was great speaking to you, and please welcome Pastor Dave.
So Cameron and I go way back, and I remember 20-some years ago him coming to me with this idea of Airshow Ministries, and he wanted to get this car and then make it look like one of the Blue Angels. And he drops all the vision and everything else, and he wants to go to these air shows. And I've been to car shows, and I've been to one air show. And so I know there's a lot of Christian organizations at the car shows and reaching people for Jesus, but I don't know a whole lot that are doing it for air shows. And I'm going, okay, this could be pretty cool. And then he drops the drawings of the car and everything else. And I just remember looking at him going, dude, you just want a cool car. I'm just going to help you fund get a cool car, you know, kind of thing. And every now and then, somebody comes up with a ministry that's just outside the box, and I get excited about that. I go, man, I never even heard about this before. This sounds really dumb. There's no way it's going to work, so I'm on board. I just want to see if the Lord could do something, and he has. And so I went with Cameron when he was in Grand Junction a couple years ago for the air show, and he says for the five people that come over the tent, We had hundreds of people that were coming over the tent. They wanted to see the car. They wanted to sit in the car. We were able to hand them a Bible. They wanted prayer. I mean, it was very, very fruitful. So I would encourage you to go to that website. I think God's doing a really good work with him. So with that, if you need a Bible, raise your hand. And we are going to be in the book of Exodus. We are going through Exodus 21. And last week we started servitude versus slavery. And so I told you there was going to be a part two, and I'm here to tell you there's also going to be a part three. So there's just a lot to cover in this area, you know. And I kind of already went over last week how slavery in the Bible is not like the slavery that we experience here in the United States and in Europe and things like that. It's completely different. And so it was more of a way to help the poor, that they could sell themselves into servitude to someone else for 6 years. And it was temporary. In the seventh year, they go free. And we read that in Exodus chapter 21. So with that, I wanted you to see a couple of other things. God had a remedy for the poor that would be in the nation of Israel. As they go in and take over the land of Canaan, as they're there, there are people that are just going to fall into poverty. So what are they supposed to do? Well, in Leviticus 19, verse 9, it says, when you reap the harvest of the land, you shall not wholly reap the corners of your field. So they weren't supposed to glean the corners of their field. They're supposed to kind of round it off and kind of lead that corner there the way that it is. Nor shall you gather the gleanings of your harvest, and you shall not glean your vineyard, nor shall you gather every grape of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and the stranger. Now that is very important to know, because God doesn't just care about the Jews. He also cares about the foreigner. He cares about the stranger. He cares about anybody that wants to come through the land, do business with Israel in the land, or come and stay in the land. They're the stranger, but he cares about them as well. And so even if the stranger is poor, they also have the same rights as the Hebrew people that are poor. It's important that you see that. In Deuteronomy 24, verse 20, it says, when you beat your olive trees, you shall not go over the boughs again. It shall be for the stranger, the fatherless, the widow. When you gather the grapes of your vineyard, you shall not glean it afterwards. It shall be for the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow. In other words, the poor and the stranger in the land were given opportunities to glean the edges or pick the lingering fruit on the trees after their fellow Israelites harvested the land. And also, the fellow Israelites were commanded to lend freely to the poor. In Deuteronomy 15, verse 7, it says, if there is among you a poor man of your brethren within any of the gates in your land which the Lord your God has given you, you shall not harden your heart nor shut your hand from your poor brother, but you shall open your hand wide to him, willingly lend him sufficient for his need, whatever he needs. And then we were also, they're told, you aren't to charge interest when you're lending to the poor. In Exodus 22, verse 25, if you lend money to any of my people who are poor among you, you shall not be like the money lender. To him you shall not charge him interest. It speaks of that also in Leviticus 25, 36 through 37. And if you're too poor to be able to afford the sacrifices that you need to bring every year to the three annual feasts that they're being recommended, that they're being told to go to, we're told in Leviticus 5, 7. If he is not able to bring a lamb, then he shall bring to the Lord for his trespass, which he has committed, two turtle doves or two young pigeons. One is a sin offering, the other is a burnt offering. In verse 11 it says, but if he is not able to bring two turtle doves or two young pigeons, then he who sins shall bring for his offering 1/10 of an ephah of fine flour as a sin offering. He shall put no oil on it, nor shall he put frankincense on it, and for it is a sin offering. So if you're extremely poor and you couldn't even afford two turtle doves, you can bring a 1/10 of an ephah fine flour, okay? So God even made it available for them. If you are going through a difficult time, you can still bring me an offering. You can still bring me an offering. Now, for the extreme poor that cannot get by at all and have incurred a debt and they can't seem to repay it, that is what chapter 21 is in Exodus here in verse 1. It says, now these are the judgments which you shall set before them. If you buy a Hebrew servant, he shall serve 6 years, and in the seventh he shall go free and pay nothing. For 6 years, he gets to go and attach himself to a family that's doing well. They will provide for all of his needs. They provide shelter for him. They provide clothing for him, food for him, and also to work the land, thus learning the necessary skills it would take that when the seventh year comes along, what happens? They go free. To do what? Go back to the land that God has given them, work their land, and now they have the skills to do it. And so that's kind of like on-the-job training. And so this indentured servitude is nothing like the slavery that we had here from the Atlantic slave trade that the United States participated in before the Civil War. And the Bible makes it very clear. This type of slavery is wrong. And we went over this last week in verse 16 of 21. It says this, he who kidnaps a man and sells him, or if he is found in his hand, shall surely be put to death. That's called man-stealing. That's exactly what the slavery was, before the Civil War. It was man-stealing. And God's word makes it very clear. That's wrong, and if you do that, you should be killed. You should be killed. That's how serious God was on the matter. So when we go over slavery in context of Israel, the Jewish nation, it's not that kind of slavery. It is mostly servitude. They have found themselves in such a position they can't do anything else in order to get out of debt, so they go and they work for someone else for 6 years, and then the seventh year, they go free. Now, Deuteronomy kind of gives us a little bit more information on that. In verse 12 of chapter 15 of Deuteronomy, it'll be up here, it says, if your brother, a Hebrew man or a Hebrew woman, is sold to you and serves you 6 years, then in the seventh year you shall let him go free from you. And when you send him away free from you, you shall not let him go away empty-handed. You shall supply him liberally from your flock. So now they're not just going to let him go. Okay, you're free to go back, work your land. You've learned the trade and everything else, what it is you're supposed to do. No, they give him the resources they need to begin this new venture. Okay? Flock from your, given you from the flock, from the threshing floor, grain. And from your wine press, from what the Lord has blessed you with, you shall give to him. Why? You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you. Therefore, I command you this thing today. Never forget what it was like to be a slave in Egypt. And so the way that you were a slave in Egypt is not the way you're going to do it when someone comes and indentures himself to you, okay? Instead, when they go out, you're going to give them resources to be successful. You're going to give them those resources of what they need to do. And so, again, hopefully in those 6 years of service, They've learned how to be a good steward over resources, have better life skills, and they don't fall into poverty again. And so those 6 years was kind of an on-the-job training for them to get their feet back under them once again when they're let free. So slavery or servitude for the fellow Jew in Israelite society is more of an on-the-job program training so they don't fall back into that pattern again. So here in verse 3 of chapter 21, it says, if he comes in by himself, he shall go out by himself. If he comes in married, then his wife shall go out with him. And this seems right, but it seems like it's those next couple verses we kind of stumble over. So in verse 4, it says, if his master has given him a wife, and she has borne him sons or daughters, the wife and her children shall be their masters, and he shall go out by himself. That makes sense, right? Let's move on. We're all kind of wondering, what is that? What is up with that? Well, the thought here is that while he was a servant, he's already serving, maybe he's been serving for a year, maybe he's been serving for 2 years. The master of the household now has a woman that has indentured herself to him to work for 6 years, okay? But he also sees, hey, I think she'd be pretty good for you. You're single, she's single. What do you think? Yeah, I would love to marry her. Yeah, I would love to marry him. Okay, great. He was playing matchmaker as he had all these different servants. Okay. So they get married. And so maybe they got married at 3 years into his service, maybe a year into her service. And so when he is set free, she still has 2 years left of servitude, stays with the master. Okay, along with the kids, if they maybe had one or two kids during that time. So there's three things that could happen here. One, he could wait 2 years until his wife gets done with her servitude and the kids with her. Two, he could go to work now that he's free, save enough silver shekels to redeem his wife and kids before she worked off her servitude if he worked hard enough. Three, he could do what it says in verse 5 and 6. He goes, you know what? I had it pretty good with my master. I really believe he could take care of me better than I could take care of myself. And here's proof of how much he loves me. He even brought me my bride, you know? And so he could do what it says in verse 5 and just stay there and be a servant to him for the rest of his life. Verse 5, but if the servant plainly says, I love my master, my wife and my children, I will not go out free. Then his master shall bring him to the judges. He shall also bring him to the door or to the doorpost. His master shall pierce his ear with an awl, and he shall serve him forever. Deuteronomy says it this way, and if it happens that he says to you, I will not go away from you, because he, what? Loves you. And he also said, since he prospers with you, then you shall take an awl, thrust it through his ear to the door, and he shall be your servant forever. Also to your female servant you shall do likewise. Why is he willing to stay with the master? Two reasons. He loves him. Why does he love him? Because obviously his master has treated him very, very well. And Deuteronomy tells us, under his master, he prospered. And so he's looking at this and going, I got it pretty good here, you know? I was able to get this amazing wife while I was here. I've been able to learn these amazing skills. I've prospered under his leadership. And he has taken care of me better than I probably could take care of myself. I want to stay here. I found a good thing. I found a very, very good master. This is known as a bondservant. And we touched on it last week, but we're going to get into it a little bit more here in a moment. We are going to continue on here. Verse 7, and if a man sells his daughter to be a female slave, she shall not go out as the male slaves do. If she does not please her master who has betrothed her to himself, then he shall let her be redeemed. He shall have no right to sell her to a foreign people, since he has dealt deceitfully with her. And if he has betrothed her to his son, he shall deal with her according to the custom of daughters. If he takes another wife, He shall not diminish her food, her clothing, her marriage rights. And if he does not do these three for her, then she shall go out free without paying money. So, if a man sells his daughter to be a female slave, the maidservant was bought, but will not really be a slave in this category, but be the master's wife or the wife of the master's son one day. Then he shall let her be redeemed if all of a sudden it doesn't please him to have her there. If her master did not marry her or decide not to give her to his son, the master is still obligated to respect her rights under God's law. At first, when you look at this law, you kind of think it's a little unfair. Why would God allow for a father to sell his daughter into servitude? It's a great question. And so what we need to understand is that these laws, it benefits. There's some safeguards in it. The father who sells his daughter was not just trying to make money in the transaction. He's not trying to get rid of her. The father who is selling his daughter into servitude is trying to probably improve her condition in life. He's poor. He's not doing that well. Okay? And so what he is trying to do is he's trying to improve her situation in life. This is kind of an arranged marriage. The poor man would send his daughter to the rich man in hope that she would become a permanent member of his family. She was entering into a conditional form of servanthood in hopes of marrying the rich man or his son, one of the two. In ancient times, a woman who did not belong to a household was vulnerable to all kinds of danger. And so when God's law is able to afford her these specific protections, if she this is called marrying up. We've all heard that before. Well, dude, you really married up. You know, we know what that means. Okay? We know what that means. And so it's kind of like, yeah, we did, you know, and things like that. And it usually speaks more of the physical beauty of our wives. But back then, to marry up was more of a social status thing. It had everything to do with you were making this amount, wasn't doing so. Hey, you married up. Hey, they're really rich. And now you're up there with them, you know, high society kind of thing. And so that is what's going on here, is that he's trying to help his daughter marry up, okay? He's trying to help her marry up. It's interesting because it says in verse 8 here, it says, if she does not please her master, who has betrothed her to himself, then he shall let her be redeemed. He shall have no right to sell her. He can't just sell her off to someone else now, okay? And somehow it fell apart. He has dealt deceitfully with her, promised her everything. So the dad said, yes, you can marry. He gets the bride price and everything else. He's saying right here, if it doesn't work out, he could redeem her back. The family could buy her back. If all of a sudden they saw that, yeah, this isn't what we signed up for, they could just use that money he gave them and all of a sudden just kind of give it back. Well, that might not work out, as we'll see here in a moment. What if they really needed the money or they were going to lose even more? They were indebted, and so they needed that money to pay off debt. And now she is now sold to him, but now she is not going to be his wife. Now what? We've already spent that money. We'll get to that here in a second. It says in verse 9, it says, if he has betrothed her to his son, he shall deal with her according to the custom of daughters, which would be great. You're now a rich man's daughter. That's a great status to be able to have there. But then it says, if he takes another wife, so he first took her for himself, for whatever reason, it doesn't work out, they're not able to redeem her. But he wants another wife. Guess what? You're still going to treat her like a wife. And you are not going to diminish her food, her clothing, her marriage rights. So now you have the burden of taking on two to be your wife, and you're going to treat them equally. If he does not want to do that with her, verse 11, if he doesn't do these three for her, then she shall go out free without paying money. She can go back to her family. They couldn't redeem her back. We already spent the money. Okay, well, I'm going to get another wife, but if I get another wife, then I have to pay for both of them. So I'm just going to let her go back free to you. That is a possibility. That could happen as well. That can happen as well. And so, again, the family that kind of like sells her off to this other family to up her position in life so she can marry up, all of a sudden it didn't end up that way. because of them, not because of her. And guess what? They're saying, well, you can redeem back. Well, we've already spent the money. Okay, well, I'm going to get another wife anyway, but if I do that, then I got to pay for both of them, and I can provide for both of them, so he can now just let her go back to the family. He can let her go back to the family. So, from chapter 21, 12 through 36, we deal now with capital crimes, personal injury, criminal negligence. But Dave, there's so much more of slavery we have to talk about. We do. But we're going to talk about it in this vein of going through capital crimes for those who are slaves and aren't slaves. Personal injury for those who are slaves and not slaves. Criminal negligence for those who are slaves and not slaves. That is how this is broken down, 12 through 36. Because if you don't see it that way, it looks like you're jumping around to this, then you're jumping around to this, jump around to this, and then you jump around. No, it's broken down to, now let's talk about capital crimes. One that is going to require the death penalty if you do this. And then we're going to talk about personal injury. What happens if there's personal injury, whether it's to a slave or a free man? What is supposed to happen there? And what about just negligence in general? Didn't mean for it to happen, no. But you didn't keep the animal on the leash. And it gored Melvin over here. And so there's an issue we got to talk about, you know? And so again, these things are going to come up in society. What's the right thing to do? Well, before we look at some of these things, what the right thing to do, we have to understand that God has raised up the judges. I talked about that last week, how they're called Elohim, because they're supposed to judge like the righteousness of God. Okay? And so he's going to raise up judges. In Deuteronomy 16, verse 18, it says this, "You shall appoint judges and officers in all your gates, which the Lord your God gives you. According to your tribes, they shall judge the people with just judgment. You shall not pervert justice. You shall not show partiality, nor take a bribe. For a bribe blinds the eyes of the wise and twists the words of the righteous." Here we see the heart of God. God does not want the judges to pervert justice. They're not to show partiality. They're not to take bribes to influence the decision of what should be judged. God wants just judges. In Deuteronomy 24, 17, "You shall not pervert justice, do the stranger or the fatherless, nor take a widow's garment." So here, justice isn't just to be meted out to the Hebrew people, but also for the stranger in the land. No partiality. Well, he's a Hebrew, he's a stranger, they have an issue, I'm obviously going to go for the Hebrew. No. Okay, no partiality. You have two human beings before you. There's an issue. Judge justly. Don't show partiality. And just because someone's trying to give you tickets to the Nuggets game, no. You know, you're not going to go on in his favor. Certainly won't if they give you Rockies tickets. But anyway. So, again, don't pervert justice. And then in Deuteronomy 25, verse 1, it says, "If there's a dispute between men..." It doesn't say a Hebrew and a stranger in the land. It says between men, "they come to court, and the judges may judge them, and they justify the righteous and condemn the wicked." They represent God. They represent God. God also does not want you to oppress servants or slaves. Deuteronomy 24, 14, "You shall not oppress a hired servant who is poor and needy, whether one of the brethren or one of the aliens who is in your land within your gates." So there could be a servant that is a Hebrew. There could be a servant that's a stranger or alien in the land. And guess what? You're not to oppress them. You're not to oppress them. The word oppress in the Hebrew is ashach. And it means to exploit, to act wrongly towards, to treat unjustly or violent towards. This is also the heart of God. Don't oppress the hired servant, either a Jew or an alien, which means don't exploit them, don't act wrongly towards them, or be violent towards them. This is the heart of God. Deuteronomy 24:17 says, "You shall not pervert justice, do the stranger or the fatherless," again, to emphasize again how with the stranger, it's the same as with the Hebrew servant. Okay. You're not to return a runaway slave of another nation. Interesting. Deuteronomy 23:15. "You shall not give back to his master the slave who has escaped from his master to you. He may dwell with you in the midst, in the place which he chooses within one of your gates, where it seems best to him. You shall not oppress him." Now, why do you think a slave of another nation would run away? Because he's being oppressed, and they're being cruel to him or her, okay? And they're being treated as property. And they're hearing that Israel has become this nation, and if you run away to them, they won't send you back. How awesome is that? In Israel, you'll be treated like a human being, not a piece of property. How will you know a person is a runaway slave from a surrounding nation? There's usually a mark on them. There's a cutting. There's a branding for all to see so people will know that you are indeed a slave. Dave, how do you know this is talking about a servant from another nation? Because we're going to see here in a moment, if you're a Hebrew slave and you're being abused, you can go to the judges and they would set you free. That's why. So here in these verses, we can kind of, we see the heart of God. He wants just judges. He loves the stranger. He wants everyone to be treated kindly and equally in the court of law, whether you're a Hebrew slave or an alien slave. And so he wants these just judges. So now as we go through these next verses, knowing that in the background, all the things that we're going to go through about what are the capital crimes, these judges that are going to be brought up in every town at the gates are the ones that determine these things. Okay? So here in verse 12, it says, "He who strikes a man so that he dies shall surely be put to death." Doesn't just stop there, though. Okay? However, there's a however here. If he did not lie in wait, if it wasn't premeditated, if God delivered him into his hand, meaning it's accidental, and he did not lie in wait, but God delivered him into his hand, then I will appoint you a place where you may flee. And this will come up later, but there's cities of refuge that when an accident like that happens, you go flee there. They'll protect you until the judges can inquire what actually happened in order for you to be deemed innocent, okay, that it was an accident. But if a man acts with premeditation against his neighbor to kill him by treachery, to premeditate, you hate him, you want to kill him, and you do. That's murder. Guess what? "You shall take him from my altar that he may die." And we went over this with the sixth commandment. You shall not murder. The long and short of it is if it's premeditated, you're going to die. And if it was an accident, then you'll be able to go to the city of refuge and flee until the judges sort it out. Verse 15, "He who strikes his father or his mother shall surely be put to death." Can I hear an amen? Again, the judges are going to determine if this is a rebellious adult child, if the intent was to assault and do bodily harm to the parent. The judges are going to be able to make those decisions after they inquire about everything, talk to the neighbors, talk to everybody that knows his child. You know, were they provoked? Were they, you know, all that kind of stuff will be taken into consideration. And if it just ends up being a bad seed, then yes, they're going to be killed for striking their parents because the intent was probably to do more harm than actually happened. Verse 16, "He who kidnaps a man, sells him, or is he found in his hand, shall surely be put to death." Again, man-stealing. We've already gone over that. That is absolutely wrong. And then in verse 17, "And he who curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death." Rut-row, how many of you would be here today? Never once said a swear word to your parents? Yeah. Lord, just visually let me see how many people be here right now. Wow, it's just my wife and myself. What do you know? Wow, you guys are all gone. You were all gone. Now, we read this and we think this is a little harsh, but the idea behind this is that there's an adult child who threatens their parents, has already shown this rebellious attitude as well as this lifestyle for a long time. Again, this is going to be brought to the judges. Deuteronomy 21 actually explains it a little bit more. Deuteronomy 21, verse 18 says, "If a man has a stubborn and rebellious son who will not obey the voice of his father, the voice of his mother, who when they have chastened him will not heed them." This could be, remember, when you're raised up in Israeli society, you have a plot of land that was given to you and your family. So as a son, you need to go and work the land. No. No, you got to work the land. This is how we make money and everything else. And you have a rebellious son or daughter that's not willing to do anything there on the land. And they won't listen to you. They're not showing you respect. And so then his father, his mother shall take hold of him, bring him out to the elders of his city, to the gate of his city. And they shall say to the elders of his city, "The son of ours is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey our voice. He is a glutton and a drunkard." So, you know, today that's basically being in your basement playing video games. But it is speaking of not only not working the land, but then going and getting drunk and taking, just being a part of the pleasures of this world. And then the elders are the one that's going to make all the inquiries and everything. If they indeed find rebellious and he's being rebellious to them, there's no repentance at all. Then verse 21, "Then all the men of his city shall stone him to death with stones, so you shall put away the evil from among you, and all Israel shall hear and fear." You know, it's interesting because with all the writings that we have, Hebrew literature, things like that, we don't have one example of this ever happening. It's there. We don't know if it ever happened or not. I would think it's a great deterrent, let that kid memorize, Deuteronomy 21 or whatever. I imagine, maybe an adult son had been taken to the elders and he saw the error of his ways and saw what was coming next and he goes, "I repent," and said, "Okay, good, let's go back. Let's monitor this a little bit more." And then all of a sudden the parents saying, "He's stellar, man. He's doing great." And so, again, do you guys remember, I think his name was Michael Fay, who got caned back in 1994 in Singapore, And there was all this, all these surveys, and it was split down the middle here in the United States. It was like 49%, said, yes, he should get caned. And like there's 49% that say no, and there's always that 2% that goes, "I don't know," But it was like just, it really divided the country. He got caned four times, big long stick, and just whack on his backside, And we're talking a guy takes a run of like 10 yards and just goes wham, And so afterwards, he actually shook the guy who caned him's hand. And the person who ministered that saw that as being very, very honorable. But it was right down the middle. He vandalized a bunch of cars. He, stole a bunch of street signs when he was in Singapore. They found him in his room, so he was definitely guilty. And so vandalism and that kind of theft is really, really low in Singapore. I wonder why. And isn't it interesting? It was an American that was over there doing that stuff. It wasn't any local kids doing this. And he was 15, I think, I think he was 18 at the time, And so it was one of those that was just right down the middle. And I look at that and go, man, I honestly think that you would see that go way down. If Castle Rock adopted that policy, I don't think you'd see any graffiti happening here, You wouldn't see any. And I think there'd be less people that before the caning. I'd be for it, but, I think it'd be a great thing to do because you wouldn't have those things, And it was humiliating for him and everything else, and we get that. But it's because it's humiliating, because you don't want that to happen, you don't do those things. There's a deterrent there. There's a deterrent there. And this is a deterrent. Look, if you're going to keep this up, you're going to die. And the whole town is the one that's going to come out and stone you. You know? So it doesn't just go with I need for you to work out here in the land. No. Take him to the elders, and then they stone him. Okay? I think that there was probably a lot more up into that point, but this guy, for whatever reason, doesn't want anything to do with God and be obedient to him and what he was created for and everything else, or obeying his parents, and it's kind of like, there's nothing left to do, you know? And so again, these are things that they already had written, and in order for them to have society be able to function the way it needs to function. And now we have some personal injury situations. In verse 18, if men contend with each other and one strikes the other with a stone or with a fist, and he does not die but is continued to his bed, and if he rises again, walks about outside with his staff, then he who struck him shall be acquitted, meaning from the death penalty. He shall only pay for the loss of his time and shall provide for him to be thoroughly healed. Just seems to make sense that, a couple men got in a squabble, got angry, got heated. Someone hit the other person, but hit him so hard that it actually put him out for a while. Okay. Well, if that happens, guess what? You have to pay the compensation to the man and his family at that time that he lost in order to be in employment to be able to make money for his family. Seems to make sense. If he rises again, walks about outside with his staff, he recovers so he doesn't die. Guess what? You're not going to be paying the death penalty for that. And shall provide for him to be thoroughly healed. And so again, it speaks of that financial help to those that they have injured. Medical expenses, whatever it takes. The judges will decide what it is you need to do to compensate them. You know, makes sense. Now, if a man beats his male or female servant with a rod. Dave, there's your caning. Okay, well, let's look at this for a second. If a man beats his male or female servant with a rod so that he dies under his hand, he shall surely be punished. Notwithstanding, if he remains alive a day or two, he shall not be punished, for he is his property. Wow, that sounds a little bit different. Well, the word beat here is nakah, and it means to strike either lightly or severely. Okay? The word rod, Hebrew word, is shavet. It means staff or stick. It doesn't mean whip. That's a scourging, by the way. That's a scourging. Punish is the Hebrew word nachem, and it means to avenge. Means to avenge. The verb always is in reference to the death penalty. Interesting. The implication is that this is judicial vengeance. This is carried out by the court system of Israel. You don't get to take personal vengeance out on the person. So a murder of a servant is the same judgment as a murder of a free person. Notwithstanding, if he remains alive a day or two, he shall not be punished, for he is his property. It sounds like you hit him so hard that he almost died, but for 2 days he hung around and then he died. I don't think that's what's happening here. The word alive is not in the original Hebrew, for one. The King James says it this way: notwithstanding, if he continued a day or two, he shall not be punished, for he is his money. The word continue in the Hebrew means to stand or to stand upright. Meaning in a few days he stands up, he's going to be okay. In other words, he recovers. He shall not be avenged, no death penalty. However, if there's a lingering disability, the judges are going to decide what to do. The word property here, hey, Dave, right here, it says their property. Yeah, but it's a different Hebrew word. It's kaseth, and it means money. So if you hit your male servant and put him out of commission for 1 or 2 or 3 days or a few days or however long it is, guess what? You're going to lose money. And because you're going to lose money, they're thinking that's probably going to be good enough. Okay. That he's the one that's going to lose. The master is going to lose out on not having an able-bodied servant not working. The servant is a working asset to the master's estate. And now the servant is not able to do his job. Now, the judges are also going to look at something as well. If this is something that was done in the way of more than just one stroke of the rod or the stick or something like that, and it was actually, it was kind of like a hit because you were supposed to do something, you didn't do something, but when he made the hit, it inadvertently startled the guy, he tripped over a rock, and then all of a sudden he goes flying and hit his head. Well, that obviously wasn't the intent of the master, okay? Yes, the master should be more careful next time. He's going to be out for a little while. Guess what? That's on you. The judges might not look at that of going, he's mistreating you. We're going to get into mistreatment here in a moment, okay? We're going to get into that here in a moment. And so the Old Testament seems to affirm the full personhood of these indentured servants. As a matter of fact, Job says this. Job, when he's talking to the Lord, says, if I've despised the cause of my male or female servant when they've complained against me, what then shall I do when God rises up? When he punishes, how shall I answer him? Did not he who made me in the womb make them, meaning his servants? Did not the same one fashion us in the womb? Job is saying, you know, I'm very careful of how I handle my servants. And the reason I'm careful is because if they complain against me, I listen to them. Because if I don't listen to them and I mistreat them or if I'm cruel to them, what is going to happen to me when God rises up and says, how did you treat this other person? How did you treat your servants? And if he treat them harshly, he's thinking, then I'm going to be treated harshly by God, is what he's thinking here. And instead he says, I've treated them fairly. Because the same person who fashioned me fashioned them in the womb. Job is saying, I see them as equal. I see them as human beings, not property. Not property. And so, in other words, you're supposed to take care of your servants and not mistreat them. So, if masters were to take care of their servants, then it only stands to reason that you're not supposed to be harsh or cruel to your servants. Thus, if that happens, they should be able to go to the judges. That is why we read in verse 26 here. If a man strikes the eye of his male or female servant and destroys it, he shall let him go free for the sake of his eye. And if he knocks out the tooth of his male or female servant, he shall let him go free for the sake of the tooth. Those aren't given because those are the only instances that a servant goes free. If you blind him in one eye or if you knock out a tooth, those are the only two. No, what is being said here is that if you mistreat them to the point where they're disfigured, guess what? They're going to go free. Hey, I have a complaint against my master. Well, what's the problem? He's very cruel. And he's been mistreating me. Really? You look fine. All of a sudden takes off his shirt and you see all the scarring on his back from being beaten by a rod. Judge is probably going to look at that, call the master in. He's going to go free. And so these are just some examples of the larger context of this. Is why when I was saying in Deuteronomy 23, the runaway slaves come into Israel, that you're just going to receive them, you're not sending them back. That's how we know these aren't Hebrew slaves. Because the Hebrew slaves could go to the judges and just say, I'm being mistreated, or this guy is so cruel, and here's the results of it. Here's the disfigurement of myself, or this is what's going on, and the judges will get involved with that. The judges will get involved with that. Now, In verse 22 here, going back up here. If a man fight and hurt a woman with a child, so she gives birth prematurely, yet no harm follows, he shall surely be punished according as a woman's husband imposes on him, and he shall pay as the judges determine. We're actually going to start with that next week, so just put a pin in that. It's just too much to explain here of why this is speaking of life for life. Okay, but it's a good little piece. But if any harm follows, then you shall give life for life. This is just going to be the criterion for everyone. life for life, unless it's accidental, okay? But it's going to require you life for life. You take a life is going to be taken from you, unless it's accidental, as we've already seen. If it comes to eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, stripe for stripe, what that means is that equal justice, equal compensation. It doesn't mean because he knocked out your tooth, you now get to knock out his tooth. Because he blinded you in one eye, you get to blind his eye. So when you see that stupid bumper sticker that says, an eye for an eye makes the world blind, that's just dumb. And that's just not even wanting to open your mind to exactly what the Word of God says. You bring him to the judges, and they're going to go, okay, because you did this, this is what you're going to have to do to compensate this person. Equal justice is what that means. Equal justice. That's why it goes on and says, for if a man strikes the eye of his male servant and destroys it, he shall then strike the eye of his master. Doesn't say that. You get to go free, bud. You get to go free. Why? Equal justice. It doesn't mean that because your tooth gets knocked, you now get to knock out his tooth. We all know this, you know. Any sort of scrape that you've ever gotten into in school or outside of school, and if someone hits you, what do you want to do? You don't want to just hit them back. You want to hit them back 10 more times. But he only hit you one. Don't care. He's going to learn not to ever hit me again. And so it's not equal, okay? And so the judge is there to go, I know you want to pound this guy. I know you want to do this to this person. I know they did this, and you want to do this. But that's why we're here, you know? It's like, well, he hit me. Okay, but he hit me way harder than I hit him. And you get that kind of thing going, you know? And it's kind of like, okay, judges are there. Equal comps. They will decide. They're before God. They'll be praying about it. They'll be seeking what that usually happens if something like this happens, what you do. And it'll be equal justice so you don't feel like the victim. And the problem with our criminal justice system is if something happens to you, you always feel like the victim. You never get that justice, that equal compensation to where you no longer feel like the victim. And we'll get more into that when we go into some of these other laws like theft and things like that. And you see how God's system, that if they steal one sheep, they have to give you back not only that sheep, but four other sheep. You're going, cool, I'm going to leave my doors open more often. You know what I mean? But you don't feel like the victim because you actually not only got compensated, but you actually gained something in that transaction of somebody stealing something from you. So you don't feel that victimhood. Now, I want to go back here to the bondservant again. The driving the awl through the ear. When we see that, we kind of ask the question, why the piercing of the ear? Why the door on the door frame there? Why the ear itself that you take an awl, a spike, some sort of nail to drive through flesh? Why blood on the door frame? Why blood on the wood? A permanent piercing leaves a hole, a scar for life. Piercing is a mark. It's puncture, a brand upon the body. In ancient Near Eastern practices, servants and soldiers bore the name or the stamp of their master or leader branded or punctured or cut into their bodies to show which master or general they accompanied into battle. There were others who would mark themselves to show which gods they worship. Galatians 6:17, Paul says this, from now on, let no one trouble me. Why, Paul? Because I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's been scarred. All the trials that Paul has been through, all the beatings he has taken for the person of Jesus Christ, he bears in his body the marks, the scars of the Lord Jesus. Don't you dare question my loyalty to my Lord and Savior. I bear on my body the marks of following Christ. Jesus also bore the scars of a bondservant. Go to Philippians chapter 2. In Philippians chapter 2, we read this. In verse 5, it says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, coming in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross." Interesting. Jesus is being obedient even to the point of death on the cross. The cross is where he had his flesh pierced on the wood of the cross. John 20, verse 19 says, "Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, when the disciples were assembled," this is after the resurrection that night, "in the fear of the Jews, Jesus came, stood in their midst, and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side." What was he showing them? Scars, piercings. By the way, he still has those scars today. And he's going to always have those scars. Permanent mark that speaks of his grace, his great love for us, his willing servanthood. So why the door? Why put the ear to the door? The word door appears 38 times in the New Testament. Jesus is the one that says, "I am the door." He said that twice in John 10. "Most surely I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. If I am the door, if anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture." A door is an entryway. It puts forth an opportunity to move from this one environment to another. It's precisely what this is all about. It's a metaphor. A door can be used to represent opportunity. We've all heard that, hey, opportunity's knocking, you know. Come through the door, opportunity's knocking. The door into the kingdom of heaven can only happen through Jesus. He's the door. It's why Jesus would say in John 14, 6, "I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through me." You want to get to heaven? It's got to be through me. It's got to be through the sacrifice I have done for you on the cross. Just like you walk through a door, you go through Jesus to get to heaven. Jesus is the door. Door frames in the Bible should take us back to chapters 12 and 13 of Exodus. It's at the Passover lamb where the blood was applied where? On the doorposts. The lintel on the top of the door, the two doorposts. The blood of the sacrificial lamb on the doorframe of the Hebrew house is one of the most iconic pictures that we see. And we see it here. Take the blood of the lamb that's right here. You go up to the lintel and the two doorposts. You go up here, two doorposts. You go up here, the two doorposts. You should see the sign of the cross there. Right here, boom. Up here, here, here. Gonna take the blood from this, go up here to the lintel, two doorposts. Up here, two. That's the sign of the cross. The sacrificial lamb that was done in Exodus before they left out of being in slavery to Egypt was gonna be through the blood of the lamb. That speaks of Jesus. Speaks of later on that it's gonna be him on the cross that is gonna set us free from sin. Into servitude with who, though? God. When they left Egypt, they left a very, very cruel master. But guess what? Who is Israel now going to serve? God. But in serving God, they are going to prosper. By serving God, they're going to be taken care of. And it's the same thing with us. When we receive Jesus, guess what? He's going to take care of you. You, for the first time, are going to know why you were created. To serve the living God. That's why. To serve the living God. And so we have here, you walk through the door after the blood was applied, led to the Israelites out of bondage, the servitude of Egypt, in order to serve and worship God, the one true God. And so we have this picture of the blood of the sacrificial lamb, speaks of the blood of the Messiah, Jesus on the cross, as well as the blood of the servant, the bondservant, who for the love of his master leans his ear to the door frame. His ear gets pierced on the wood of the door frame. Speaks of the piercing that Jesus did on the cross, on the wood, him saying, I am the door. Crossing that threshold through the door needs to happen voluntarily. He doesn't make you do it. They didn't have to put the blood up there, but they chose to, and then they chose to walk through. And once they did that, they were no longer in bondage to Egypt. And now they can go and serve the living God. Why the ear? There's no separate word for obey and listen in Hebrew. Listen and obey is the same Hebrew word. It's two sides of the same coin. You cannot listen without obeying. And you can't obey without hearing. Our ears represent being obedient to our Lord. When we hear God, it means we obey God. And here is the Shema. And it's Shin Mem Ayin right there. It means listen, contemplate, meditate, obey. It means all those things. Can't have obey without this. And you can't have this without obeying. Today, we're free to choose. We hear. We're here to choose whether we're going to walk through that doorway or not. We get to make that choice. We're told in Romans that we're a slave to sin. But when you receive Jesus, now you become a slave to Jesus, to righteousness. And you're now free to do what you ought to do. You're now free to do of why you're created. The purpose and meaning now comes into your life. But it is something that everyone has to choose. You cannot be a Christian because your mom or dad is a Christian. You can't be a Christian just because you walk through these doors. You're a Christian only one way. And that is you receive Christ. He is the door. You walk through the offering that he gave on your behalf on the cross. The Bible makes it very clear. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is what? Death. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. God has given us that free gift. And that is his son. It's interesting how when you go through the word of God in the Old Testament, how it points to Jesus. Because the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed. And when you understand the New Testament, now you have the right filter that when you're reading the Old Testament, you go, oh, I see Jesus there. Oh, I see Jesus there. Oh, I see Jesus there. Yep. It's so fun going through God's word. I never tire of this. You know, I always have these aspirations like, oh, I could do the slavery thing in one teaching. And then I hear God laugh. I'm going, all right. I see what's happening here. But it's interesting to find out when Jesus shows up in the New Testament, when Jesus shows up, when he's here on earth, isn't it interesting? He doesn't all of a sudden say, hey, slavery's wrong. At that time of the Roman Empire, 2/3 of the people in the Roman Empire were slaves. 2/3 of them. That's a pretty big deal. That's a pretty big issue. Jesus never touches on it. Why is that? Because there's a greater issue. And the greater issue is you need Jesus. You need me. I'm not here to cure all the ills of the world. I'm here to cure the one ill that is going to send you to hell. And that is not knowing me. That is bigger than any issue in the world, even today. And we're going to find out that if you're a slave and you come to know Jesus, great. Now be the best slave you could possibly be. Don't try and run away. Don't try and get your freedom or anything like that. Be the best. Why? You need to be a light and a witness to your master. That's why. You ever wonder why you're under such a taskmaster right now? They've been praying that I get another job. Oh, you wouldn't believe where I am right now. It is so difficult. I know. God has you there for a reason. Why? Because he wants you to be a light to them. That's why. God needs light everywhere, in every occupation, every field. We need godly men and women in Hollywood. You can think of any industry that is so carnal. So what? Let's put Christians in there. That's why God's calling you there, so you could be a light and a witness. Who else is going to touch those people? You ever wonder why Paul was railroaded the way that he was? So he could do what? Present the gospel to who? Caesar. How else was Caesar going to hear it? I love in Galatians when he's talking about, oh man, thank you for your prayers. There's even people here in Caesar's own household that is praying for you. What? Yeah, they've come to know Jesus since I've been here. How would they have come to know Jesus? Unless Paul was railroaded to the point where they're chained to him. I mean, you know, he's under house arrest, but he's actually literally chained to a person. Talk about a captive audience. I see. You think I'm in chains. No. You're in chains. Do you know Jesus? You're going to hear a lot about him. There's not a whole lot you can do about it because we're chained. So, you know, and it's kind of like, come on. That was God. Because he wanted to reach that jailer, wanted to reach that soldier, he wanted to reach people in Caesar's own household with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're going to take communion here tonight, so hold on to the bread and juice. But if you don't know Jesus, now's a really good time to receive Jesus. Because if you don't know Jesus, don't take communion, okay? Because communion is for the body of Christ, the family of Christ. So let's pray. Father, if there's anyone here that needs Jesus, I mean, you died for our sin. We're sinners. We need a Savior. God the Father sent his Son to be able to take on the wrath that sin brings upon us. He was willing to do that for us. That's how much he loved us. When I hear people say, what has God ever done for me? He sent his Son to die for you so you could have eternal life. If God did nothing more other than that, he's done more than enough. So, Father, if there's anyone here that on their own, this isn't something the friend is who brought them is pressuring them to do, or mom or dad or whoever it might be. Lord, if there's anyone here tonight, they want to make that confession. They want to be able to stand before you and say, I believe and I'm grateful for what you've done for me, that they would just pray this prayer right now. Father, I believe. I believe that you sent your Son Jesus to die on the cross for the sin of the world, my sin. I receive that. I ask you, forgive me of my sin, that you would come into my life and that you would change me. Give me an understanding of what it is you've called me to do. Give me an understanding of why I'm here on this earth. Give me an understanding of your word. And I ask this by faith in Jesus' name. Lord, if anybody prayed that prayer, that they would just know they are now a child of God, that they have walked through the door. You have said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And by receiving the work you did for them on the cross, they have stepped through the door. And they now have eternal life. And they're now part of the family of God. They can participate in communion where the bread speaks of your body and the juice speaks of your blood that you shed there on the cross. Father, we love you. We praise you. We're so grateful for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Hold on to the bread and juice. We'll take this together. If you need gluten-free, raise your hand. John, we'll get that to you. But you got to have it up high so he sees. So he sees. I'm not afraid to. Father, we are very grateful of how you reveal yourself to us, that you're the great pursuer. You loved us before we loved you. You demonstrated your great love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And so as we hold this bread, it is that reminder. Jesus walking this earth. Jesus making himself known. Jesus loving people every step he took. And that ultimate love going up there on the cross. Allowing for himself to be pierced through with the nails in his hand, the nail in his feet, the crown of thorns on his head, after taking the scourging with his back ripped open, lifting him up on the cross after all that and looking down saying, Father, forgive them for they know not what they do. What a gracious God. What a forgiving Savior. So as we take this bread, that we would remember how forgiving, merciful, and gracious you are to us. Let's partake. And the juice that represents the blood, and your word tells us that life is in the blood. And so every drop of blood that came from your body through all those piercings, all those, that scourging, hanging up there on the cross for 6 hours. All because of your great love for us. May we never forget. Let's partake. Father, I thank you very much for your son Jesus, and may we never forget all that you've done for us. And because you died for us, how can we not live for you? And so we would remember that as we leave here tonight, whether we go out and get some food here and have dinner, that we would pray for our servers and that we could be that light and a witness wherever we go this week. Give us those divine appointments to be able to give our testimony of how we came to know you. And we ask these things in your son, Jesus' name. Amen.
If you guys will stand with me, we're going to sing one more song together.
Sun.
any of you guys need prayer, we're going to have leaders up here. Don't leave if you need prayer, please. And we love you guys so much. Have a great night.